This show is intended for general purposes only, as individual situations may vary. Statements made should not be relied upon as recommendations or solicitation. When discussed, past performance is no guarantee or indication of future results. Nelson Financial Planning offers securities through Nelson IVES Brokerage Services, member FINRA and SIPC.
Good Sunday morning. This is Bud Hedinger. Next on News Radio 102.5 WFLA, the longest-running radio show in Central Florida, Dollars and Cents with my good friend Joel Garris from Nelson Financial Planning. You can call him at the office this week at 407-629-6477 to schedule your free consultation to discuss your retirement plans. Or you can talk to him right now at 407-916-5400.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the program Dollars and Cents. My name is Joel Garris of Nelson Financial Planning, and here on Dollars and Cents, Central Florida's longest-running radio program. In fact, we help you make sense out of all of those different decisions that have anything to do with your dollars. Here's the format of the program. We usually arrive on a Sunday morning with a host of topics. Every week, it includes sort of a recap of the prior week. We will, of course, do that this time around. And then we'll talk about death. Well, maybe that's not such a fun topic, but we're going to share with you the contents of an interesting article that was forwarded to us from a client talking about some fairly simple things that you can do to avoid issues when your spouse dies. And speaking of that, we lost a very well-known singer this past, well, I guess it was a few more than a week ago, Aretha Franklin. And I don't know if you've seen this, but Aretha Franklin died without a will. We're going to have to talk about that, too. That's certainly an interesting topic when you consider Aretha Franklin's estate worth somewhere around the ballpark of $80 million. My goodness, dying without a will, that's a real problem. So those will be the topics of the day. And, of course, there's always room for your topic as well. So in order, though, to share what your topic is, well, you've got to do one of two different things. You got to pick up the phone, give us a call at 407-916-5400, or toll-free 1-855-545-1025, or you can send us an email at Joel, J-O-E-L, that's me, at, and that's the little ampersand thing, nelsonfinancialplanning.com, N-E-L-S-O-N, nelsonfinancialplanning.com. So those are the ways in which you get in touch with us here on the radio program. And I guess we'll start with the past week. Past week, a lot of headlines, coming out of Washington, and it seems always that there is headlines coming out of Washington. I think the media, the mainstream media, is just simply transfixed by President Trump and his administration. And they just, it's like, it's almost like the mainstream media is like driving down I-4 and there's a wreck off the side of the road, and they just can't help themselves but to brake and to slow down and look at that wreck. And I guess that's human nature. But they really had a lot to dissect this past week. And frankly, I'd start to be a little nervous if I'm President Trump, I guess, in this equation, right? I mean, my primary lawyer, my fixer, as he's been described, Michael Cohen, pled guilty, and my good buddy that publishes the National Enquirer apparently got an immunity deal. And then lastly, the person that for decades has been working for me and putting the financials together and writing out the checks, and then all I got to do is sign them. He also got immunity. So you got to kind of wonder how all of this plays out. Obviously, this past week, there was a tremendous amount of conversation about impeachment. I'm not sure about the likelihood of that. First of all, a lot of these dots have to all connect, and I'm not sure that they necessarily do. But even if they do, I think it's important to note this statistic, which is one that we uncovered this morning. If you look at the 12 months leading up to the last impeachment trial in America, and for those of you who may have forgotten, it was about 20 years ago. Boy, it seems like it was not that long ago, but yeah, 20 years ago. And the president was Bill Clinton. And interestingly, that happened in 1998 in his second term. And in the 12 months leading up to the trial itself, the Standard & Poor's 500 index, which is a pretty good broad gauge of the market, gained 25%. Interesting. And to put that into perspective, what did the market do this past week? It was a big old, well, not necessarily a big old yawn. The market did, in fact, based upon some parameters in this kind of a debate in the financial media about whether this is true or not, but many are claiming that the stock market now hit or became the longest bull market run in history. And that happened on Wednesday with all of this news breaking about the plea deal. And on Tuesday was the plea deal. Oh, and then also the campaign chair, Paul Manafort, also was found guilty, although that seems like that's kind of on completely unrelated stuff. But you all kind of get that all those things lumped together, more of an association problem with that. But with all of that breaking on Tuesday, the market went ahead on Wednesday, specifically the S&P 500, and in some measures became the longest-running bull market in history, starting from a low of 666 on March the 9th of 2009. For the week, the overall S&P 500 finished up for the week. So the week itself was actually relatively positive, with the S&P 500 gaining close to 1% for the week and hitting that record on Wednesday. So that's certainly been kind of a back and forth path so far this year for the markets, because the year started out very, very strongly. And then obviously it's kind of been meandering back and forth. As we mentioned last week on the program, in the letter that we just sent out to our clients, we described that as sort of a bit of a seesaw that has been happening, because the real conversation is this economic data that continues to come out and how the Federal Reserve will respond. And speaking of the Federal Reserve, they also made some headlines this past week with the release of the minutes from their last meeting. There was also some President Trump tweets about that, making sure, well, he wants to make sure they don't raise the interest rates too quickly. And that's a fair point, because you don't want the Federal Reserve to raise rates too quickly, because you run the risk of undermining current economic growth. But certainly the economic numbers, corporate earnings numbers, are very, very strong. The counterbalance to that, or the other part of that seesaw, is this interest rate conversation, which I think out of anything this past week, setting aside all the political stuff, is really the more important thing to be watching. The reality is that certainly a lot of headlines associated with President Trump's various associates, but at the end of the day, the market is really more of a barometer of where the economy is and what's happening to things like inflation and unemployment and corporate earnings, much, much more than what's happening in the headlines. You know, the other comment too is that, as I think we were talking about last week on the program, or maybe even the week before, if you look at kind of the tea leaves as to how the midterm elections will appear to now be playing out a little bit closer to the elections themselves, it very much looks like the Senate will stay in Republican control. Republicans may actually pick up a seat. House is a bit more of a toss-up. Democrats have to kind of run the table pretty good, but certainly they could. The reality is that with at least one portion of Congress controlled by Republicans, it would be hard to pull off an impeachment when you've got that the sitting president and a chamber of Congress being the same political party. And even if that does, you know, we'll go back and share the interesting statistic that we did earlier on the program, which is that impeachments itself or impeachment trials don't necessarily undermine the economy. All you got to do is look at the last one, and that's a pretty good run. The 12 months leading up to Clinton's impeachment, the S&P 500 actually went up by 25%. So an interesting statistic that hopefully brings some perspective to the noise of the mainstream media, which seem to be fixating on potential impeachment of President Trump this past week, particularly with all the news breaking of his associates. Just remember that one the next time you hear that story. 12 months leading up to Clinton's impeachment, the market was up 25%. So I guess I'll take that in an impeachment any day of the week, and I bet you would too if you're looking at your investments. Anyway, so there's some thoughts on kind of the current status of the world at large. When we get back, we will talk a little bit more about Aretha Franklin. What was her? R-E-S-P-E-C-T for Aretha Franklin. And she died without a will. My goodness, unbelievable. We'll talk about that when we get back here on Dollars and Cents. This is Joel Garris of Nelson Financial Planning on News Radio 102.5 WFLA.
Download the free iHeartRadio app today.
This is Bud Hedinger. You know, you can talk to Joel Garris of Nelson Financial Planning right now on Dollars and Cents about anything to do with your money by calling 407-916-5400. Give him a call. It's time to make sense of your dollars.
Hey, welcome back to the program, ladies and gentlemen. Dollars and Cents here on News Radio 102.5 WFLA. So I'm sure you've heard the news. Aretha Franklin passed away without a will. Fascinating turn of events, especially for an estate that size, $80 million, and without a will. Here's how it works. You wind up having to go through a process that bears everything. So Aretha Franklin had four sons. What they've had to do out in California, that's probably a bigger issue anyway, because California's got a lot of taxes. They had to go through and file in probate court that they were named as parties interested in estate, in her estate, because there was, simply put, no will whatsoever. And it's funny because often it seems like everybody's sort of getting along. If you read kind of the court documents and some of the press reportings on this, but yeah, I can tell you right now, $80 million, you know, somebody's going to start to not get along pretty quick in that equation. That's just kind of how it always turns out to be. And the reality is that you really do have to question the advice and the counsel that her advice, you know, and I guess that's true of a lot of these people, whether it's, you know, musicians or professional athletes or any of these folks, it just seems like time and time again, you hear this over and over, and it just kind of mystifies me as to why, you know, if you've got $80 million in assets, you've got people, you know, that whose job that is to make sure that your financial picture is as good as it can be, and to not even have some baseline will or a trust or anything that would that would provide the game plan, and not have to go through the court system and not have to go through the expense and the time of that. It just boggles my mind, the advice that some of these people get, you know, that are living in that ultra high net worth, rare air, professional athletes, professional entertainers. My goodness, what? I mean, the simplest of things. And by the way, even though you may not have $80 million, the same conversation applies to you if you've got 8,000 or 800 or 800,000 or 8 million. It's important to have those documents in place. And in today's world, you can get that so easily. I mean, you know, there are legal services online that you can just, you know, log into and print a document and sign, and to have something in place. It just really boggles my mind how you could put yourself in that position where when you die without a will, it basically then becomes the state statutes to determine who's going to get what and how things are going to be valued and whether certain parts are going certain places. And when you've got multiple beneficiaries, and certainly in this case, Aretha Franklin had four sons, that's an argument waiting to happen that could have been resolved very easily. Now, in Aretha's case, at $80 million, she probably wanted some kind of a trust in that case. But just to not even have a simple will, leaving it all to her four kids, stops to boggle the mind. So the message on the program today is, while you may not be Aretha Franklin, while you may not have $80 million, you still need to have some kind of a will in order to make sure that your beneficiaries are not relying on the state statutes to determine who's getting what. Whether you need a trust or not is a different story. We've certainly dedicated some programs to that topic in the past. We'll summarize it real quick. Oftentimes, the vast majority of people that have trust don't really need a trust. Why? Because you can actually go through your accounts and establish beneficiaries pretty easily without the cost of, depending upon where you go, a $3,000 40-page document that simply says, leave it all to my kids. If that's what it says, then you can certainly go around and add beneficiaries to accounts, name beneficiaries on accounts, retitle things so it passes automatically to named beneficiaries. Super easy to do that. It's just paperwork. It costs you nothing. Very simple to be able to do that. And so at the very least, though, have the will. The trust may or may not be necessary. Probably not if you're willing to do the work to add beneficiaries to the accounts. And here's the thing about the trust, and we've certainly seen this before. You go out, you get yourself a fancy trust, and then you don't bother to retitle any assets into it. Because the only way the trust owns stuff is if it's actually the titler or the owner of an account. So if you've got a joint account and you go out and create a trust and you don't re-register the joint account to the trust, then there's nothing in that trust. It's just 40 pages of paper with a bunch of legalese written on it. So if you've got to go through that process of re-registering the assets, well, shoot. Why don't you just go ahead and add beneficiaries directly on it if that's kind of all that your trust says? Now, obviously, if there's special situations where a special needs situation or you're concerned about your beneficiary spending the money in an instantaneous manner, okay, fine. Then that's where you would reopen that conversation on a trust. But if it's just simply leaving it to the kids outright, you got paperwork you got to do on that anyway, so you might as well just do it and save yourself some money on the trust by simply naming them as beneficiaries. And that's sort of along the lines of this article that a client forwarded to me, written by someone whose spouse had just passed away, kind of going through some of the things that they learned, and in particular, making sure that, again, you know, it's on a simple checking and savings account, naming beneficiaries. In this person's case, they had to hire a lawyer at $465 an hour is what the article says. That's an expensive lawyer, although price tags on lawyers are going up, to petition the court to name me as executor of the estate. And then simply because they never bothered to name a beneficiary. Funeral expenses. They had to employ, because they had property in different states, and wanted to be buried in a different state than where she died, a tremendous amount in funeral costs because they had not done any thinking on that either. The article continues. The medical bills, this person was diligent on paying all the medical bills that came in. Unfortunately, a lot of them were covered by health insurance or Medicare. And so he paid bills and then had to wait a very long time before he got his money back. So certainly some interesting things that can play out on the way to the grave. But if you don't take a moment and at least do some level of preparation ahead of time, that trip to the grave may get a little windy for your beneficiary. Certainly in the case of Aretha Franklin, that is the case as well. I think Elvis Presley also died without a will. I mean, the examples are tremendous, particularly among professional entertainers and professional sports figures. And you would think that these people would be able to have somebody that said, hey, you know what, you probably should, you know, put together this simple document. But unfortunately, we keep seeing the examples. They are examples, though, for the rest of us. Get affairs in order and simplify things for your beneficiaries. With that thought, we will take a break. When we get back, we will continue the program here on Dollars and Cents. We've got open lines, so if you've got a topic that you want to talk about, pick up the phone, give us a call at 407-916-5400. Toll free 1-855-545-1025. Or you can send us an email. We'll check emails during the break. The email address is joel@nelsonfinancialplanning.com. So that's how you can get in touch with us and add your topic to this morning's program here on Dollars and Cents with Joel Garris of Nelson Financial Planning on News Radio 102.5 WFLA.
Money. this is Bud Hedinger. You know, you can talk to Joel Garris of Nelson Financial Planning right now on Dollars and Cents about anything to do with your money by calling 407-916-5400. Give him a call. It's time to make sense of your dollars.
Welcome back to the program, ladies and gentlemen. Dollars and Cents here on News Radio 102.5 WFLA. It was going through the mail this morning, and as many of you know, my oldest is a senior in high school, which means that we are in college application season, and of course starting to look at what, well, not starting to look at what are the numbers. We have pre-planned for that many, many years ago with a college savings 529 plan, but the cost is just incrementally increasing, particularly over the course of the past 10 years. Today, 44 million Americans owe over $1.4 trillion in student loan debt, which is an increase of 139% in just the last 10 years. And folks, I just scratch my head on that. Okay. I scratch my head on that for multiple reasons. What is going on at colleges and universities in America today that their cost has gone up by 139% over the course of the past 10 years? Now, obviously, there's probably not a direct parallel there, but the cost of college and universities keeps increasing at this ridiculous rate, and I'm not sure where that money is going, other than the fact that the school gets to build a new building. Because when I talk to people that work as professors, they tell me that their income hasn't doubled as a college professor over the course of the past 10 years. So it's not going there. And it's not really helping to offset the price of books, because the price of books is still up. Where's all that money going? It just boggles my mind when you start to look at these numbers and see how much debt there is out there. You've really got to look at cost as a major factor in this college decision, because it's just not enough to just say, well, I'll go and get a college degree and that will be great. But the reality is that for the amount of money that you have to spend for some of these college degrees and the amount of debt that these kids are taking on, you've got to be very careful that the degree that you're getting is going to allow you to at least cash flow it, because right out of the gate. Because one of the worst things that we see is when you graduate and you decide to continue to defer the payment of your loans. And you can certainly do that if the job that you got, you know, the income was not enough to live on and pay for your student loans. So you can do a deferment. But that doesn't mean that the loan locks in and it just stays at that same level. The reality is that the loan continues to accrue interest each and every day that you don't make the payment on it that you should have made. So then 5 years goes by, you say, okay, fine, I'm starting to, you know, I've got a little bit more income, maybe I'll try and tackle those loans. Well, guess what? The payment's going to be much higher to get them paid off over that same time period, because you spent 5 years not paying them, 5 years more of interest. And by the way, the interest on these is not particularly cheap, particularly in light of where current interest rates are. So the deferment process, while it certainly is an option that everybody loves when they get out of college, because then they don't have to worry about the payment of the debt, the reality is it just compounds the debt. You're literally having that loan continue to sit there and grow interest for as long as you're not paying those payments. And then that interest just simply gets added to the balance. So then by the time you start to pay your loans, you owe a whole lot more than what the numbers are. And certainly that's a lot of the explanation as to why college costs have gone up as much as they have. Interestingly, the flip side, if you look at home ownership, today nearly 40% of Americans own their home free and clear of any debt. So somewhere the message is getting through that perhaps you should be managing your debt better, particularly when nearly 40% of homeowners in the U.S. don't have a mortgage. The real issue is how far back this student loan stuff is really sitting the next generation. 130, stop and think about that number, 139% increase in the amount of student loan debt outstanding just over the course of the past 10 years. Something's wrong there. And maybe it's that deferment's too easy. Maybe it's that these schools are just increasing their cost and allowing kids to borrow more and more money. Maybe it's just the process of signing a student loan is just way too easy. I wonder if these young adults that are going to school that are signing these loans have any idea about the ramifications. What would probably be a good idea in that situation is perhaps you spend the summer before you go off to college taking a required course in personal finance and debt. That might help to really drive the point home, although by then it's probably too late because you've already signed up to go to college. Maybe that's got to happen between the junior and senior. Maybe that's got to happen between the junior and senior year. At some point, okay, that message has got to get conveyed. I know the kids in school these days, they have to take an economics class. Why not a personal economics class? Because that's a huge burden on young adults who graduate with such massive amounts of debt. And that's outrageous. 139% increase over the past 10 years. Something's wrong there that needs to get fixed. Cost of a quality higher education in America should not be going up by that much. It just doesn't make any sense. Says a dad who's about ready to send three kids to college. So let's be very clear on my bias on this topic. Yeah, it's ridiculous. Make sure you're looking at the numbers. We are starting to very much engage in that process at home on a personal basis. And, there's definitely a cost benefit analysis to be run on that. That is for sure. Anyway, we will slide to a break. When we get back from the break, we will continue the conversation here on Dollars and Cents. Here on News Radio 102.5 WFLA. Open lines to call on in and give us your topic du jour here at 407-916-5400, 855-545-1025, or you can send us an email. That email, joel@nelsonfinancialplanning.com.
This is Bud Hedinger. You know, you can talk to Joel Garris of Nelson Financial Planning right now on Dollars and Cents about anything to do with your money by calling 407-916-5400. Give him a call. It's time to make sense of your dollars.
Welcome back to the program, ladies and gentlemen. Dollars and Cents here on News Radio 102.5 WFLA. This is your host, Joel Garris of Nelson Financial Planning. Recently named a finalist for the 2018 Florida Companies to Watch. We're very excited about that. We certainly owe a hearty thanks to all of our clients who helped position us in that way, where we are in the running for this statewide award. So that's pretty cool stuff indeed. Speaking of cool stuff, we certainly buy a lot of it, don't we, as Americans? When you look at consumption and consumer spending, it certainly is a major part of the economy. 70% of our economy is directly related to consumer spending. Interestingly, if you look at other major economies in the world, it is not nearly as much. If we go to China, for example, the Chinese economy, it's just 39% Chinese consumption. So what's fascinating about that is if you look at ways that that economy could expand, it certainly is on the flavor of consumer spending, because their economy at only 39% consumer spending, and I guess ultimately that's what they're trying to do as they shift away from excessive government spending. I think we've all seen those articles where they've built cities that are basically unoccupied over there to boost the economy. You're spending money, but what that also means is that the Chinese are borrowing a lot of money. So I know that there's always a lot of conversation about our debt as a country. You want to get nervous about a debt load, go check out what the Chinese government owes on their end, a much higher number. Interesting information that doesn't get talked about much for perspective's sake in the mainstream media, but at 39% of their economy being making up as consumer spending, certainly room to maneuver on that. What's fascinating about that consumer spending in China is how much more of it proportionately occurs online in China versus versus here in this country. Okay, there's still, even though we hear a lot about companies like Amazon and ordering online and all that kind of stuff, less than 10% of annual retail spending in the U.S. is completed as an online purchase, less than 10%. Meanwhile, in China, that's about 25%. So it's a much higher acceptance of spending and buying online over in China than it is in the U.S. So that's kind of fascinating if you stop and think about that, given how ubiquitous technology is here in the U.S. Versus China. Not to say that technology is not pretty widespread in China, but clearly here there's much a greater level of infrastructure across the board. And so when you look at consumer spending and where that is happening, we are still very low in comparative measures in terms of the percent that actually is spent online. Now, imagine if that number continues to grow and does hit that same percentage as what happens over in China at that 20%. Certainly, there will be some ripple effects. That is for sure. As you look around, what's going on in terms of construction? I know here in Central Florida, the news this past week of how Lowe's was closing down the Orchid Supply Hardware. I know there's one in Winter Park where, you know, literally that place was brand new. I mean, that place has just been open for, I think, less than a year. And so they're shutting that down. And so you wonder how big that trend is going to be as you start to see a continuation of the increase in the amount of shopping that occurs online here in the U.S. versus other places. So I think that will be certainly a very fascinating topic that will play out over the course of the next couple of decades as we continue to get more and more comfortable with the notion of buying or shopping online. Interesting, a lot of that shopping is now not even done at a traditional computer. a lot of it is done on the phone. I know I'm particularly guilty on that one on a personal level, because most of what I get on Amazon, I do the searching and the purchasing right on my phone. And as that technology continues to expand, certainly consumers will be boosting their consumer spending on online. And the role of technology also has some pretty widespread implications for things like productivity as well. The productivity gains over the course of the past 40 years have really just been tremendous. And I think this is something that you also don't hear a whole lot about, of what the average American worker can do in a week is compared to where those levels were, say, 40 years ago, is just tremendous. If you look at productivity gains over the course of the past 40 years, the average American worker has increased their productivity by over 100%. That means that the average worker can complete in an hour the same amount of work that it took them 2 hours to do 40 years ago. Stop and think about that. That the level of productivity in our economy and the productivity gains that have occurred, particularly over the course of the past 40 years, basically doubles up the amount of work that's getting done in a week by every single American. Pretty dramatic. Okay, so the next time somebody questions the ability of the American economy to continue to produce, you just look at numbers like that, and some pretty dramatic numbers when you start to talk about productivity and productivity gains and how much that has been and how much that has contributed to the overall economic picture. So certainly some interesting little statistics on the economy, consumer spending, how we spend it, and just how much that productivity has risen over the course, particularly over the course of the past 40 years. So basically today you get done in 1 hour what used to be done in 2 hours. Pretty dramatic when you stop and think about it in that perspective. Well, that's about it for the program. Thank you all for listening, hopefully we were able to provide you some good information, or at least some things to think about here on the program. If you missed it, or you want to hear it again, or you missed a certain segment, we put it back up on the various social media networks on tomorrow morning, so feel free to catch it there. This has been Dollars and Cents. This is Joel Garris of Nelson Financial Planning here on News Radio 102.5 WFLA.
This is Bud Hedinger, and you've been listening to Dollars and Cents with Joel Garris of Nelson Financial Planning. If you missed any part of today's show or want to listen to it again, check out the radio show at www.nelsonfinancialplanning.com or connect with them on Facebook or Twitter. Be sure to call Joel this week at 407-629-6477 to schedule your free consultation to discuss your retirement plan.
Fees, commissions, expenses, investment costs come in all shapes and sizes. Do you know how much your investments are really costing you? At Nelson Financial Planning, we believe that costs should be a major consideration in your financial plan. After all, the lower your costs are, the more you get to keep for yourself. This is Joel Garris, and I invite you to get educated about your investment costs. Visit NelsonFinancialPlanning.com or call us today at 407-629-6477 to set up a personal conversation to review your investment costs. That's NelsonFinancialPlanning.com or 407-629-6477 to set up that conversation.
A-plus, Better Business Bureau accredited. Nelson Financial Planning offers securities through Nelson Ives Brokerage Services. Member SIPC and FINRA. Listen to Joel Garris on Dollars and Cents every Sunday at 9 a.m. on News Radio 102.5 WFLA. This show is intended for general purposes only, as individual situations may vary. Statements made should not be relied upon as recommendations or solicitation. When discussed, past performance is no guarantee or indication of future results. Nelson Financial Planning offers securities through Nelson Ives Brokerage Services, member FINRA and SIPC.